Unfortunately, we are not permitted to sing at this stage. Thank you.
Unfortunately, we won't be sharing tea with each other after our sins, firmly resolved to keep God's commandments and to live in love and peace with our neighbor. Almighty God, our heavenly God,
confess that we have sinned against you through our own fault, in thought, word, and deed, and in what we have left undone, for the sake of your Son, Christ our Lord. Forgive us all that is past, and grant that we may serve you in newness of life, to the glory of your name.
Almighty God, who forgives all who truly repent, have mercy on us, pardon our sins and set us free from them. Confirm and strengthen us in all goodness and keep us in eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Please join me in praying our college for today on the front page of our leaflet. Holy God, you govern all things in heaven and on earth.
Enable us to be obedient to your authority, that serving you in the world, we will be faithful witnesses of your kingdom. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, who is alive and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
Said that you know me well and are pleased with me. Now, if you are, tell me your plans so that I may serve you and continue to please you. Remember also that you have chosen this nation to be your own. The Lord said, I will go with you and I will give you victory. Moses replied, if you do not go with us, don't make us leave this place. How will anyone know that you are pleased with your people and with me? If you do not go with us, your presence with us will distinguish us from any other people on earth. The Lord said to Moses, I will do just as you have asked, because I know you very well, and I am pleased with you. Then Moses requested, please, let me see the dazzling light of your presence. The Lord answered, I will make all my splendor pass before you, and in your presence I will pronounce my sacred name. I am the Lord, and I show compassion and pity on those I choose. I will not let you see my face, because no one can see me and stay alive. But there is a place beside me where you can stand on earth. When the dazzling light of my presence passes by, I will put you in an opening in the earth and cover you with my hand until I have passed by. Then I will take my hand away, and you will see my back.
Thanks be to God.
Our appointed psalm for today is Psalm 99. The Lord is King, the people tremble. He sits on his throne above the winged creatures, and the earth shakes. The Lord is mighty in Zion, he is supreme over all the nations. Everyone will praise his great and majestic name. Holy is he. Mighty King, you love what is right. You have established justice in Israel. You have brought righteousness and fairness. Praise the Lord our God. Worship before his throne. Holy is he. Moses and Aaron were his priests, and Samuel was one who prays to him. They called to the Lord, and he answered them. He spoke to them from the pillar of cloud. They obeyed the laws and commands that he gave them. O Lord my God, you answered your people. You show them that you are a God who forgives, even though you punish them for their sins. Praise the Lord our God and worship at his sacred hill. The Lord our God is holy.
Glory to the Father,
and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen.
Second reading is taken from Paul's first letter to the Thessalonians, chapter 1, reading from verses 1 to 10. From Paul, Silas, and Timothy, to the people of the church in Thessalonica who belong to God, the Father, and the Lord Jesus Christ, may God and peace be yours. We always thank God for all you and always mention you in our prayers. For we remember before our God and Father how you put your faith into practice, how your love made you work so hard, and how your people and how your hope in our Lord Jesus Christ has served. Our brothers, we know that God loves you and has chosen you to be his own. For we brought the good news to you, not with words only, but also with power and the Holy Spirit, and with complete conviction of its truth. You know how we lived when we were with you. It was for your own good. You imitated us and the Lord, and even though you suffered much, you received the message with the joy that comes from the Holy Spirit. So you became an example to all believers in Macedonia and Achaia. For not only did the message about the Lord go out from you throughout Macedonia and Achaia, but the news about your faith in God has gone everywhere. There is nothing then that we need to say. All those people speak about how you received us when we visited you, and how you turned away from our idols to God, to serve the true and living God, and to wait for his Son to come from heaven. His Son Jesus Christ, whom he raised from dead, and who rescues us from God's anger, is coming. Hear the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Teacher, they said, We know you are a man of integrity, and that you teach the way of God in accordance with the truth. You aren't swayed by men, because you pay no attention to who they are. Tell us then, what is your opinion? Is it right to pay taxes to Caesar or not? But Jesus, knowing their evil intent, said, You hypocrites, why are you trying to trap me? Show me the coin used for paying tax. They brought him a denarius, and he asked them, Whose portrait is this, and whose inscription? Caesar's, they replied. Then he said to them, Give to Caesar what is Caesar's, and to God what is God's. When they heard this, they were amazed, so they left him and went away. This is the Gospel of Christ.
Praise to Christ our Lord.
On our sheets, we will say together the baptismal creed. Sentence number 11. I believe and trust
in God the Father, who made the world. I believe and trust in his Son, Jesus Christ, who redeemed humankind. I believe and trust in his Holy Spirit, who gives life to the people of God. I believe and trust in one God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen.
Thank you. Please be seated. Lord God, I pray that you speak through the words that you have given me. Amen. I'm really fascinated by this gospel passage. And normally it's taken about giving to Caesar what is Caesar's, but I'm taking a different approach today. We need to look at the context. Jesus had just entered Jerusalem triumphantly, and he started really criticizing those for whom religion is a vested interest. And the pun is intended. You see, I'm here in my vestments. As one of the priestly class, the priestly class that Jesus was criticizing. His warning is valid for clerical types like me, but also for you non-vested types. After all, we are all baptized believers, and therefore we are all ministers for God. Let's go back to the vested types of that time, the chief priests and the elders. They responded to Jesus' challenge by challenging his authority in turn. After all, they hadn't ordained him. And the vested types realized that he was speaking about them. And when they sought to seize him, they feared the multitudes. The Pharisees had been conspiring to destroy Jesus for a while, but Jesus hadn't fallen for their tricks, and he continued in criticizing them, showing them up for their hypocrisy. And they countered, intending to destroy Jesus' influence, either by discrediting him in the presence of the crowds, or by causing him to make a misstep that could get him into trouble with the Romans. And in our gospel lesson today, they ask him the first of three trick questions. They ask, is it lawful to pay taxes to the emperor or not? They must have spent a long time cooking up this very cunning attempt to trap Jesus. Jesus would either disobey the Roman law, or he'd disobey the Torah, and he'd either alienate himself with the masses and get their approval and get Roman persecution. Very, very cunning. The tax in question was a very unpopular poll tax. Many British citizens will remember the poll tax wasn't very well received in the UK either. It was a day's pay that simply disappeared into the emperor's coffers, imposed per person, and it was imposed when Judea became a Roman province. Tax evasion was not taken lightly by the Romans. There were dire consequences, much worse than the receiver coming and auditing you today. There is also a very important spiritual problem, because the poll tax was paid with a denarius coin, which bore the image of Caesar and the inscription, Tiberius Caesar, August son of the divine August. Magnus Augustus High Priest. Of course, it wasn't actually written in English, but us English people think everything was. The Jews considered this image idolatrous, and the inscription is blasphemous, which meant that no truly observant Jew would even carry a graven image in their pocket. In fact, this coin was so controversial that on another occasion, people of Jerusalem preferred death to allowing Caesar's image to enter Jerusalem on standards. So having this coin in the temple for a Jew would be a problem if they are following the law. But nevertheless, the denarius was in common use among Jews, to shun only by deserters. So the problem for Jesus is that this cunning question had been carefully crafted in a way that would compromise him. If Jesus answered that the taxes are lawful, he will firstly be advocating disobeying God's law by endorsing the offending coin with its graven image, and he will also be alienating the people who hate the tax as well as the coin. But if he answers that the taxes are not lawful, the Romans will surely arrest him for sedition. Either way, Jesus loses and his enemies win. The cunning priest thought, checkmate. But Jesus turns the trap back on them when he asks to see the coin. And then they have no problem presenting the offending coin, presumably from their very own pockets, exposing their hypocrisy yet again. What does this mean for us? Are we hypocrites too? Something that has challenged me deeply as a member of the religious caste, the baptized Christian, is Jesus' condemnation of our caste's hypocrisy. He says, "You brood of vipers, how can you who are evil say anything good? But out of the overflow of the heart, the mouth speaks." That's to hypocrites. What are the coins that us religious types carry with us, either realistically or emotionally? What commands do we pick and choose to obey? Where do we compromise when it suits us? We're all very good at seeing the others doing things wrong. I can think of some vipers I know, politicians, people who steal public funds, administrators who are corrupt. All of us know others who are getting this wrong. But I'm not talking about them, I'm talking about us. When we get caught out and proven wrong, how do we respond? Isn't it tempting to act like the persecutors of Jesus and to lash out in hypocritical condemnation? We see this often, don't we? We see it in others, but do we see it in ourselves? Do we dare take the log out of our own eyes before trying to take the speck out of our neighbors? Why? Why do we put so much emphasis on judging the others for their religion, their occupation, their race, their class, their manners, their outer appearances, maybe their behavior, their sexuality, or other laws or commands, when we ourselves are guilty of the same or similar or even many worse things? Why do we pick and choose the sins that are so abominations to us that then very conveniently ignore the other things? In one of these lessons this week, Richard Rohr reminds us about the importance of the communal sins, the big sins that we commit as society. The good news is that Jesus gives us all the answer. As we pray, forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. I admit, I struggle. I'm often personally sinful or wrong, as my beloved wife and daughters know even better than any of you. And many of you have known me long enough to know I'm far from perfect. No, don't argue. Anticipating a bit of say, no, you are perfect. But what's worse than these personal sins that we seem to be so obsessed about are the institutional evils that contribute to oppression, and we can all of us perpetrate these. I have done this and I do this. We buy unethically sourced or produced items to save or earn a denarius, resulting in damage to God's creation and people. I could go on and on, but luckily for me, time is short. So I don't have to bear all my sins. But I'm sure maybe some of us in the congregation here or the congregation out there also realize we also need to say, Father, forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. I admit, I have figuratively nailed Jesus to that cross. Maybe some of you have too. If so, I know that he looks at us with his loving eyes and he says the same thing that he said to those who literally nailed him to the cross. Father, forgive them, for they don't know what they are doing. Amen.
Most high and glorious God, come and enlighten the darkness of our hearts. Give us right faith, certain hope, and perfect love, that everything we do may be in fulfillment of your holy will, through Jesus Christ our Lord. As we celebrate the Holy Eucharist to the glory of God, and in thanksgiving for his mercies, let us pray for the Church in Christ Jesus and for all people according to their needs. Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, you promised through your Son, Jesus Christ, to hear us when we pray in his name. We pray for your Church throughout the world, and especially for this diocese, with Stephen, our Bishop, together with Tabor, our Metropolitan. Give your Church power to proclaim the gospel of Christ and grant that we and all Christian people may be united in truth, live together in love, and reveal your glory in the world. Lord, in your mercy. We thank you, Creator God, for the resources of the world and its beauty. Give to all a reverence for your creation and make us worthy stewards of your gifts. Lord, in your mercy. We pray for the nations of the world, especially for this country and its leaders. And in these times of great change, may our leaders have the wisdom and courage to look to you, Redeemer of the world, for steadfastness as a guiding light, for a timeless view of our human societies and all our fellow creatures. Give wisdom to those in authority. Direct this and every nation in the way of justice and peace, that all may honor one another and seek the common good. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
We pray for our families and friends and those with special claims upon us. Give grace to all whose lives are closely linked with ours, that we may serve Christ in them and love one another as he loves us. Lord, in your mercy. And in this time of COVID, we pray for those in trouble, sorrow, need, grief, sickness, or any other adversity. We pray also for those who are recovering these our prayers for the sake of your Son, our Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. So please be seated and we'll have the notices. There were a number of prayer words that came in the prayer time on Friday, so I'll read them out to you if any of them resonated with you or feel that it's for you. Listen, please, I'll be here to pray with the item service. So, I'm just going to run. Beating of the drums. Now we see through a glass dimly a rainbow, and the prayers said that it would seem that those three might be connected together. So I'll just say it again. Beating of the drums, now we see through a glass dimly and a rainbow. And then there's also a light at the end of the tunnel. Lock your back door, locksmith. Lightning bolts. Sunshine on my shoulder, relocate for safety, a delicate flower that could be trampled, and in brackets that that's political, and a pushback. And together, I don't know if you have any other notices.
The other notices are in the pew leaflet. Remember those of you as mine it is now. And there's an appeal for making face masks. And just please continue to pray for those in need. And there's some beautiful prayers in the community, so I really encourage you to take it home and pray with it in the week. I find it very beneficial to do so. Thank you again, Lynn, so much for this ministry. The greater opportunity, the offertory bowl is up at the altar. So if you'd like to make an offering, please feel free to put that. You're offering any help, either at communion or during offertory. It's up to you.
Thank you, Gavin. So please let's stand for our song, which is the Bell Foundations.
Thank you. Yours, Lord, is the grace, the power, the glory, the splendor, and the majesty. For everything in heaven and on earth is yours. All things come from you, and of your own do we give you.
Amen.
Blessed are you, Lord God of all creation. Through your goodness you have displayed, Father, which earth has given in human hands to make. For us that we come for the bread of life, blessed be God forever. Blessed are you, Lord God of all creation. Through your goodness we have this wine to offer, true to the vine and work of human hands. For us that you come to the cup of salvation,
blessed be God forever.
We shall be using the fourth Eucharistic prayer, which I do hope you know is not on your order of service. If you're using your prayer book at home, is on page 124. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give him thanks and praise.
We give you thanks and praise, Almighty God, through your beloved Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Redeemer. He is your living word, through whom you have created all things. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he took flesh of the Virgin Mary and shared our human nature. He lived and died as one of us to reconcile us to you, the God and parent of all. In fulfillment of your will, he stretched out his hands in suffering to bring release to those who placed their hope in you. And so he welcomed your holy people. He chose to bear our griefs and sorrows and to give up his life on the cross, that he might shatter the chains of the evil one and banish the darkness of sin and death. By his resurrection, he brings us into the light of your presence. Holy and gracious God, accept our praise through your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, who on the night he was handed over to suffering and death, took bread and gave you thanks, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body, which is broken for you." In the same way, he took the cup, saying, "This is my blood, which is shed for you. When you do this, you do it in memory of me." Remembering, therefore, his death and resurrection, we offer you, God, not only this bread and this cup, but ourselves, in thanks that you have made us worthy to stand in your presence and serve you. By pure grace, we ask you to send your Holy Spirit on the offering of your Holy Church. Gather into one all who share in these sacred mysteries, filling us with the Holy Spirit and confirming our faith in the truth, that together we may praise you and give you glory through your servant Jesus Christ. All glory and honor is yours, Father and Son, with the Holy Spirit, in the Holy Church, now and forever. Amen. As Christ has called us, we are bold to pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name.
Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial, and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen.
Lord, forgive us our sin, as we forgive those who sin against us. The bread which we break, is it not a sharing of the body of Christ?
We you are made of one body, for we all partake of one bread.
whole feeling out of my head, and thank you. After you share communion at the altar, I'd like you to come up to receive the wafer, consecrated wafer, bearing social distancing norms in 9 feet. Those of you at home who pray, I advise you to pray the prayer for spiritual communion, if you may join us in this ceremony.
Jesus Christ.
Christ our Lord, send us out into the world in the power of the Holy Spirit to live and work to your grace and glory.
Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us, in forgiving others, and then in being forgiven yourself. May you know the peace of God which passes all our understanding. And may that peace keep your hearts and minds filled with God's joy, God's presence, whatever circumstances you face this day and always. And the blessing of our triune God, our Creator,